Yeah, good evening. Actually, when I was asked to give a lecture here, I was hesitating. I had two subjects I was considering. First of all, I was considering to talk about Bent Larsen, who I knew very well, who was a very colorful person, your great countryman, the great Dane. We were not exactly friends, but we got along very well. We had many talks, interesting talks, and it could have been interesting, but I decided to do something else, because at the last couple of years I have been very involved in composing Endgame studies, and I want to share some of these studies with you. But not only that, another countryman of yours who has been very successful and quite good at the Endgame study is Steffen Slumstrup Nielsen. I want to show some Endgame studies by him as well. He won first prize in the tourney that was organized for my 60th birthday. Of course, when I did the judging of the for the tourney, I didn't know the names. So I was actually surprised. At that moment, he was, although he was well in his 30s, he was not known for making Endgame studies. It's some sort of secluded world. And you see a newcomer who's that age. It's quite remarkable. It's very impressive. I will show you this study later. First, I will explain a couple of things about Endgame studies, because it's important to know what an Endgame study is exactly. An Endgame study has a starting position, and it should be either right to make a draw or right to win. It could be white to move, it could be black to move. Most often it's white to move, but sometimes it's difficult to find a move for white that is suitable, and then you have black to move. Most study composers don't like to do that. The main thing is that there's a main line of the endgame study. It's just a position, endgame position, and all white's moves should be forced. Black's moves not. Black could have many different possibilities, could counter in different ways, and then you have to find resources to how to answer that. And the idea of the endgame study is that it's a mixture of science and art. And what I find most interesting about it is the way of thinking. Normally when you think, also in daily life or in chess, you think ahead. You think, what shall I do? Can I look two moves ahead? Can I think about different plans? Now, in endgame study, it's mostly completely different. It's mostly the case that you begin with the final position. So the final position should have some interesting things in it. And from that point on, you think backwards, what they call retrograde thinking. Now, while in chess, actually, the computers are not very good at all. I mean, it should be a game, and you should play this game without any help of computers. For endgame studies, it's completely the opposite. It's actually very useful to have computers to help you to see which variations are wrong and to lead you through the study. I talked recently with a good friend of mine, the Israeli international master, Yohanan Afek. He's living in Holland for a long time. We play for the same club. And he has recently been appointed to be a grandmaster in the field of the endgame study. He told me, he said, you know, it is incredible what they did in the past. I mean, I cannot imagine to make endgame studies now without the help of a computer. And I agreed with him. If you look at the past, you see all these great endgame composers. You see people like from the Soviet Union, Troitsky, Kubel, Libokhin, the brothers Platov. You see Kasparyan, Korolkov, all these great names, Gurbich. They made fantastic endgame studies. The ideas are great. And they did it without a computer. Of course, nowadays, a lot of these old endgame studies have been refuted. But some of them are still valid, and these ideas are absolutely great. I mentioned a lot of names from the Soviet Union, players from the Soviet Union. Often they had some sort of work, and the work was very boring, so they were busy making endgame studies. But outside the Soviet Union, you had, most distinctly, you had Rink from Spain, and Richard Reti, also the great player, who was a very great composer as well. Now, what I'm going to do is this. I've asked some extra nights. I'm still missing one, but I think that I can manage to do with it. First, I will show not only one study like it was on the website, but I will show three studies of Steffen Slumstrup Nielsen. The first study is a task, because this also happens in the study world, that you have certain tasks. Now, I will explain what that means. Of course, as a practical player, I'm always inclined to find the most natural studies the most beautiful. But the study composers think differently. They can see any sort of position they find interesting. I have normally this tendency, but sometimes I get carried away and also come up with some crazy positions, as I will show. But first I will show this task, as they say. It is only pawns, it's a pawn ending, but a very peculiar pawn ending. This is here, and the pawn is on g5. Now I have all the pawns, many pawns. You see here. Yes. Now it's interesting that white is has to play and win. Now, the task is how to make as many knight promotions as possible in the study. And Steffen managed to make 5. Of course, you have to make knights. You have to give check all the time, because black is also threatening to queen. So something really has to happen. I have only 4 knights, but the final knight, I will just leave it at the board, and you will judge for yourself what it is. So we start like this. That is the best knight move, the only move, yeah. Well, of course, in such a position, the only moves. If you go to f7, then you make a queen. But now you have to make a knight, because there's no other check. Queen must go here. Knight goes d6. King goes here. You must always be careful that there's not a queen promoting this check, because then it's over immediately. Third knight. King d8. Knight f7. King e8. Knight d6. King must go to e7. And still there's no possibility to make any other. The knights must keep on giving checks. B8 knight. And the final knight. And okay, that's a knight. You must take the knight, and then finally you make a queen here. And white wins. So the task was how to have as many knight promotions as possible in a pawn ending. And this is actually the best study existing. This was recently done by Steffen. Now I will, before I show the study that actually won first prize in my tourney, I want to show another study that was received very well. Oh yeah, here, this one. Yeah. This one, here this one. No, here this one. This is the second study. Now the idea of this study is that white should win. This won second prize in the RFS tournament last year. It's very important to start with D3 because otherwise there is the queen shouldn't get to c2 with check. I mean, the idea of d3 is that you lure the bishop to this square, and now you play rook f8. There's bishop f5. Check. It's the only way to do something against the white threats. And queen c2 check. Now, of course, you cannot play king d7 because this rook falls with check. So here you have a beautiful move here. And this is typical for endgame studies, that is this move. Sacrificing the rook. Bishop takes, and now the idea is this, queen a5 check, bishop goes back here, and now you sacrifice another piece, well, of course it's not a real sacrifice, because you cannot take it, because then it would be, this would queen this pawn. So you must take this. Yes, pawn. And now you see that after all the sacrifices, the situation has cleared, and it's a rather simple position. But it's really incredible that white is winning here, because the king is open. Of course, you have no mate, not even a threat of an attack. But in such positions, it's always good to have a threat of a possible discovered check. Not yet, but it's only this move stops, let's say, queen checks. You cannot move as the king yet. But black has no useful moves here. He must take the knight. And now it's interesting because you go back with the queen, with check. You see, this is what I call the disappearing trick. If the bishop moves back, you have the same position without the knight, and then you have mate here on d5. See, sometimes it's good to sacrifice a piece in that way. But that's not all. Black can also interpose his queen. And now it's really This is really nice what is happening. There's this queen b5. It's interesting that black has absolutely no moves here. This bishop is blocking the square for the queen. Without the bishop, it was a draw. You could give queen c5 check, and he has to take it and stalemate. Let's go here. Only way to prevent this, and now here, and it's finally mate. It's a beautiful study. Absolutely fantastic. Now I come to the first prize study in the tourney that I had for my 60th birthday. It is the version I show. It's not the original version, it is an expanded version. It is something Steffen came up with later. D6, yeah. Now here in this position, it's right to play and make a draw. Of course, the problem for white here is that, of course, you threaten just to take the rook and then it's over. So here you have an interesting combination to do something about this. That is bishop b3. Black takes it. And now, rook f8. That was the idea. You forced him to take your bishop, and now it is still pinned, and black has to be careful here. Because if you play rook b8, it's not enough. It is because there's f7. The main line is this: bishop takes f8. And this is actually very interesting because here white has a tremendous move. If you, let's say, the idea of black is if you take here, it looks good. There's rook b8 check. You take the bishop, you take the with the rook, and it's an easy win. Now there is it's quite an incredible move here. But so the idea is this. And that is incredible, but this move is not good enough. For the following reason. The idea, of course, of f7 is if you take with the bishop, you take here, and now you don't have the same. You don't have this rook b8, because you have to protect the bishop here, and then you cannot attack the queen at the same time. But on the other hand, here black is winning, because he will have many checks, starting with this check. King b1, rook a1 check, king c2, rook c1 check, king d3, let me see this. This, I think, there's something. The point is actually here, it's winning for black because you have rook takes f7. Okay, now we go back to this position. So the whole idea of this position is to sacrifice a knight first. You don't take immediately, you don't play f7 immediately, you must play rook f8 first. Bishop takes f8, knight takes, g takes f. And this position is amazing. Black has all this pawn is in the way. Without the pawn, it would be an easy win. Let's try some moves. This. See, otherwise, the pawn is not there. Here. Yeah. Not possible to win this. You may be careful, like has to be careful. You can also drive the king around. He always has a good square. Now I think this is absolutely great, this study, because it is unique to have these pawns there. The only thing is that I was looking for a version. Actually, if you have the position like this, it would actually be nicer if both bishops were lured into there, but it's not easy sometimes to achieve everything that you want. But I made this version of the study. It's always, if you have a study, you can also have different versions to show it in a slightly different way. Now, in this position, white should make a draw. And here, you cannot just start. If you play this move to protect the rook, which is a very sensible move, there's only one refutation, that is rook g6. Stop the diagonal of the bishop, and you win the rook. So it doesn't work. Now the whole idea of this version of the study is that you play this. Also a nice knight sacrifice. It's a nice sacrifice also. Let's take it. This version is something that what you have in endgame study sometimes, let's say the idea that you have to aim for the most economic version of the study. So let's say if in the previous study it's quite nice that you have a nice sacrifice, but in this version the king has a special function. That's the function of the black pawn. In the other study the king doesn't play. Here there's just one piece less, and so it's more economic. This is actually the best version to show the study, because here you don't have a black pawn and it's less pawns. But anyway, this is. I think it's not possible to really improve on the study, because I think it's one of the best studies that was made in the last 10 years. There's another study that I actually, this is a very complicated one. And it's based on the study of Steffen, but I couldn't find the study anymore, but I show my version of the study, which is also quite interesting. But this is one of these studies where there's really a lot of material. This is not for the practical player. I showed it to some practical players and they didn't like it so much, but I showed it to Afek and he liked it, yeah. So I think it's quite good. All sorts of pieces. A lot of pawns also. Let me see whether I have everything here. No, I'm still missing a pawn here. Yep. It's 2, it's 5, 4, 3, 4. 6. It's always good to check this very carefully whether I have all them. Yeah. So okay, the idea is that white should win. Very complicated position, what can I say? Yeah. Maybe we should have a look first a little bit what is possible here. All pieces here. But after a while it will become clear what is happening. We start with this move. very important. Because basically you force king h8. If you play this, queen takes the threatening mate, and after bishop d4, there's king d5. So, this move has to be played, and white takes. Now, of course, white is threatening mate, and black has to give checks, like in the first study that I showed, that where white had to give checks with knights all the time. You start like this. This time you must take it. Now it starts the fun. So careful, only here. And now it's what you call a staircase, what is happening. You're following the king, otherwise he escapes. It's a check, yeah. So that is the whole idea here. So check, the check all the time. This is actually Steffen's idea. And king f6. And now if you go here, then this wins. And you win by taking this pawn. Okay, that's one line, yeah. That's actually a very nice line, I think. This study is really, really fun, yeah. But you need a lot of pieces to make this stuff work, yeah. So here, rook takes e7. Now completely different picture, because if you play king takes e7, it doesn't work somehow. This was yeah, too. Of course, you take just the bishop. But now it's interesting that you can move the bishop. But there's only one square. It's here. This is a fun move. You force him to take the queen. Yeah, now you see what's happened. You cannot take the black couldn't take the queen because mate, but he wants to chase the bishop. And now actually this is still Steffen's idea, but here I changed the position in this way that now white, because it was the end of his study. But here white has to be very careful. If you play the bishop here, you attack it like this and black wins. Let's go here. I'll take it like this. Let's go here. There are some other lines that are not so interesting. Here, and you go here, finally. That's the only way. Queen d3. And now the whole idea is this, queen d8. Because if the queen is on d1, then rook g7 is saving. But here rook g7 is not saving black, because you have bishop takes c4 check and you take the queen. That is the whole idea where you had to be exact with the bishop moves. Very complicated. I hope you enjoyed this. Now I will move to some of my studies. I think this is a nice study. I will show now a study that is based on the game Ortueta Sanz. I wrote about this in my book, The Art of the Endgame, but I made actually many more studies with this same scene. And I cannot show them all here because I have these two books all full of studies that are made after the Art of the Endgame appeared in 2011. So it's a lot of stuff, too much. But I think I made a selection and I think this one is quite okay. Let me see whether I have all the pieces, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the idea is that white should make a draw. Because the problem for white is that the pawn is trying to promote. You have to give the check first. It's very important later. King goes. And now you stop the pawn. Black has this, knight b1, threatening to queen. The rook should take, that's the only way to stop this. And this is what Ortueta Sanz's idea, so it happened in one game. You cannot move the knight and you cannot move the rook. Now you have all sorts of possibilities to make nice studies with this theme. I think this one is quite nice because here white plays this move. The idea of bishop e4 is that that you cannot take this because now, you just take it back. And you cannot take this because the bishop takes. And if you take here, now you see why you had to give the check on the first move, because the king had to go to f8, and you come here, and white wins. But black has a very interesting way out. So you add one more pin. This is truly an amazing position, because apart from this, all the pieces are hanging. So there's only one way out. It's c6, and the idea of you have to sacrifice two pawns now to get this bishop check here. Bishop takes d5, it still continues like this, is completely normal. Bishop c5 check, king f7. And now there's only one move that makes a draw. That is this move. So you, the pieces are still hanging, and the ending is a draw. This was probably the best study to show because it has all the interesting ideas. Let's move on to some other choices. I made, yeah, next study, I got a third prize in a tourney in the US. On this position, white should make a draw. Yeah, it's a correct position. Now, okay, this pawns are very dangerous. The material is equal, but you have to open for this bishop, and at the same time, you have to. This pawn is too dangerous otherwise. You have to play this, so you can play bishop d2 if the pawn goes. And so c2 bishop d2 is not very difficult for white to make a draw. But this is the main line. And if you play rook takes b5, then you play rook takes c6. And black has a winning game. So you have to take here. The only move, and here it is still the case that, yeah, if you move the bishop, then you cannot win. If you play, let's say, bishop e2, rook c8. Other moves also don't win, but there's a very, like, has a very interesting combination here, and it's based on some diagonal play. This is black's move. Must take it. Check. Sacrificing two pieces. C2 check. Now, of course, you have a move like king h7. But after c1, the white pieces are disorganized and you cannot keep the position. Black is winning. You have an amazing way to save the position, it's rook b2. So you pin the king. Let's take. But it's still not over. What to do now? Again here, if you play h6, c1, black wins. So actually here you win because you have to sacrifice both your pieces. Both the minor pieces have to be sacrificed, but in the right way. The only way to do it is knight d3. Take it. Bishop d2. King takes, and six. And this is low because you don't have the pieces, and so you can play for stalemate. Now, the question is, of course, why did you have to sacrifice it this order? Because you had to sacrifice both pieces, but why not the other way? If you would do it in this way, you would lose. King e4. And now the king is close enough, Black's king. I just give an example of what can happen. King comes here, queen, and the king is there. So you have to sacrifice the pieces in the right way. I move on. This was actually, here you saw a composition with different themes mixed, mostly diagonals and sacrifices. Oh yes, this is, I have enough bishops, yeah, good.
Who did the last one?
I made that, yeah. It's all my studies, yeah. Next one is a study which has the theme of under promotion to bishop.
Is it okay with a few questions?
Yes.
Do you have any fellow grandmasters also interested in studying and studies?
Well, Benker, yeah.
Benker was
famous. Yeah. Smyslov used to be interested, but he died 5 years ago. But Benker is very old, and I think he's still active, but I think that now he doesn't make endgame studies, mostly problems, self-mates, and what I dislike very much, actually. Because actually, there's this difference between problems and studies. Studies are much closer to the actual game, and much more instructive for the player. But apart from that, I think that Shirov has an interest in endgame studies, and Galfand is interested in studies. Who else?
John Nunn?
Yeah, of course, John Nunn. Yeah, sure, yeah. John Nunn has also made studies. True, yeah. But not so many, no. So, the next study is, of course, it's possible to ask any question you want in between, any moment. C2. Yeah. This study it's quite a nice idea here that white should win. The main idea for black is actually to I showed this is the only move, because you have to get the square for the rook on d8 to keep the king here. Now I give one line, this line, which is a nice line, rook d8. If you make a bishop, you have also to make a bishop. It's the only way. Otherwise, if you make a queen, stalemate. So that's the idea of the study. Black makes a bishop, white makes a bishop. But it's not the main line. The main line is quite nice because that is if you make a queen here. So you have to go here. And of course, you must keep the king here, but on the other hand, black is now trying to create stalemates. Now queen e1 has the idea that that if you yeah, it's stalemate if you make a there's also a threat here, bishop c5, yeah. This is the main line, rook h1. And if you play bishop g1, rook takes, queen takes, Bishop. Check. This is why I had to make a bishop, yeah, otherwise queen takes d4 would be a draw. Now white wins, it's mate. Other line is the following. At this position. I sacrifice the rook if you take it. Again, bishop. Bishop d4. And now you can only win this way. And check. And this position is winning. It's not even very simple to win, because if black could, well, you can take this pawn, and you, if you could manage to get with your king to b7, and to give the queen for the rook, it would be a draw, because you can have two bishops, two pawns here, but if the king is on a8, it's a draw. But you cannot get there, so the study is correct. You move on. Different themes. Yes, this study. This study was made after, it's also my study, idea of baiting from Riga. The idea is that white should win. And the idea is actually that, again, you have a king that is locked up. You have to play for mate. So it's not enough to take this pawn, because then the king escapes. So you have to start with this move, it's clear. Threatening mate in one. If black plays rook c3, then it is a winning position. You take here, you have a technically winning position. The idea is this, f4. Now the next move is quite interesting, quite nice, because you have to win a tempo just to make a, what we will see now is the Novotny team. And what the Novotny team is will be clear soon. White has to sacrifice this knight, threatening mate again, so black has to take it. And the whole idea is this. Now, what is the Novotny team? That is, if you take here, you interrupt the line of the bishop and the rook. If you take with the rook, it's made here. If you take with the bishop, it is made there. So that's Novotny. It's a Czech from the 19th century. He mostly used this for problems, but it's also it's quite possible to also use it for endgame studies, the whole idea. But it's not all, because black doesn't take here. He starts to create counterplay, as you say. He plays first this move. I have to take it. Same idea, of course, black takes. And of course, now you don't take the rook, but you do it again. But now it's clear why what black was aiming for with f3. He has a square for the rook to sacrifice it. I forgot the pawn here, actually. It's good that I checked this, yeah. Bishop takes a4. Now, all the threats are off. I mean, you have protected against this mate and against this mate. So white has to be very accurate here. The only move to win is this. But this pawn is not here. You play here. You take here. Knight g5. Knight d4. If you take here, you cannot mate. You need a knight. But black has to find the square for the knight. The only square is here. Now you're threatening here and to liberate. But here you take. And now you get the second theme. The first was Novotny. And this is what they call Festina Lenta. That you have to play slowly. And it's a mutual Zugzwang also. Here, it's interesting. If you just, there are not so many moves. You cannot move the king. You cannot move the knight. If you play this, it's Zugzwang. So you have to start like this. Black, and this is mutual Zugzwang. If I to move, it's a draw. Black cannot move, because if you lose the c pawn, it's lost. And otherwise, a3 is mate, and bishop move to protect the pawn is also mate. Now what I'm going to show is it's an idea that I made a study based on a problem by Chiron, André Chiron, the Swiss theoretician. And so he made a problem, and I made a study out of it. Thank you. Let me see if I have everything here. That is here. Let's see. Yeah, this is right. Yeah, this is the. Now it's interesting because you have some sort of mixture between studies and problems. This means that this is a study in the way that right to play and win, but it's also a problem because it's made in 11. But it's mainly a study because it's just, I think in general, all studies are made in a certain amount of moves. Although we don't know it, I mean, only the computer knows it. We always stop when it's completely clear that white is winning, but here, just the end is made. Well, actually, if you look at the position, it's quite clear that the king shouldn't escape to e6. And of course, materially, white is a piece down, but he has one way to do it. This is the wrong way, because then black escapes. This is the right way. Also later to keep the bishop out. Let's go here. And of course you keep the king. F takes. Knight g8. This terrible threats. The only way for black is to. The threat is, of course, just to put the knight on f6 and then bishop d5 for this. The only way to try to escape for black is to play this, threatening here or here, so you must take it, and this piece sacrifice is meant to play d5. And now the bishop cannot come back to give mate. So the knight will have to give mate. So here first, no, first you play this move, this two. Knight b6. So you have to move the knight now. Because if you move the bishop, then you come to a4 and you take here. You can also still go here. So the only move here is knight e7. d5. And now it's funny, because here, this is actually the whole idea of Chiron. This is made in, actually, his study is originally made in 4 study. The interesting thing about this is that if you play the most obvious move, you could actually there's this possibility, but first you must play this move just to threaten knight c6. Black is very restricted. He has to protect this pawn, but once the knight is on c6, the bishop has to be in c7 to protect both squares a5 and e5. So you must play bishop c7. And now it's interesting, because knight c6 is absolutely nothing, because knight a4. And this is the whole idea of Chiron. First you play bishop c6, bishop c6, b7, now you play bishop a8. And this is an amazing position, because black is in a terrible zugzwang. You must take the bishop, there's absolutely no other move. If you move the knight, if you move the bishop, it can only be here, because you have to threaten, you have to do something about both threats. So you have to take, and now there's no move. The bishop cannot move. So this is actually this is a brilliant idea, but it's actually this is Chiron's idea. This is not my idea. I had to make a study out of it. I had to do this bishop here. Otherwise, white could win in many different ways. But here, the problem always with mate in four is that you see, well, okay, it's very nice, of course, but you can also get mate in five or mate in six. But here, it's the only way to do it. Yeah, I have a study, but that is more or less technical. It's made after the idea of Simcovitch. This is actually what you call a miniature, because very few pieces on the board. And it's black to move. This is one of these cases where it's black to move. Of course, the idea for black is that it has to stop this pawn from promoting, very simple. It's a miniature because only 7 pieces. Now, of course, there's also a table base for this. But okay, you can still make studies then. There's bishop g2 check. Black's idea is to attack this pawn twice. Otherwise, there's always a trick to get around it. But this king is here. This king is here. Sorry. So you have to give this check and rook to f7. Now there's only. If you play, you have 2 checks. You have to give a check, because otherwise you cannot really do something. You cannot take the bishop. If you play this, it's a draw. Because you'll go here. Rook d2. Would be nice if you take it, because then you have bishop f4. And you promote, but you go here. And this is a problem for black, for white. The king goes to a6, draw. So you have to keep the black king in a position where it cannot escape. So you have to start with this check. King goes here. This check is the only way. You must be careful that it doesn't go to a6. Let's go always on the white squares, of course. You see that you can sacrifice this rook all the time. Black cannot take it. King d1. Check. And now you see that you have to go here, because you cannot go here, because rook d2. Now, of course, there's a possibility of king takes d2, bishop f4, rook takes f4, b8. I show it. Because this is not immediately winning. But here you have the table bases, of course. The table base says that king f2 is the only way to win. Bishop e4, trying to keep it protected, but it's not successful. Queen b4, king d3, rook is unprotected. wins. Okay, we go back to the position that we had. So we had this position. We had rook d2. The king was here. We had rook d2 check. King b3. Rook b2 check. And now it's over. Because you you cannot get to a6. If you go to, let's say, here, now we have time to take just the bishop. And after this, finally, there's bishop e5 check and wins. So it's a whole, this rook has to be very careful how to maneuver to find the only way to do it. The idea is of the Russian composer Simkovich. He had great ideas, but not all his ideas were correct. I have also some other studies that are based on this, on his ideas. That what is important, in my opinion, is to find ideas to correct old studies that are beautiful, but not but they don't work. This is another example of a great study that I added something to. Study is after Evrenov. Evrenov was a lesser known composer from the Soviet Union, but he had at least one great study and also some other very good ideas. But I show now his study, but in a refined idea. Then we will see how it works. F6. This is quite a natural position. Yeah. Now the idea is that white should win. Of course, you see this diagonal, but there's still three pieces in the way. So you start with sacrificing this one. Black doesn't want to take it. Because that would lose. That's f7, and rook takes a4 check. So you must get the queen out of the way. Now it's funny, if you play f7, what is an obvious move, that's bishop takes, king g7, rook f4, d4 check. Okay, that is, there are two long diagonals in the fight. So, why doesn't do it? Here you have an incredible move, and that is knight f4. And the only idea of this knight sacrifice is just to get the square on g2 for the king. I show the idea. Takes. The other move is bishop e6, it's also quite nice. And now it's the move of Evrenov, because you have these two long diagonals, and it's actually very similar to what I showed you before when there's two diagonals and the kings are there. So you play this very controversial move. You stop the other diagonal, you open this one. This was the whole idea. to have this square for the king. That's why you have to play knight f4. F3, check, very careful now, only move. And now the pawns are in the way, and you cannot stop it. You can play bishop f7, takes, you sacrifice a pawn in f7 and will be mate. We go back to the position where I sacrificed the knight. Knight f4. So the other move is this. This is more or less a technical story, but it's still quite interesting. This is always quite interesting with studies that you have to make different things work. F7. Now, of course, you must take, because the king g7, rook f4, check, it's over. You must play queen takes, rook f4, check, king g8, rook f7. Now, this endgame is not a trivial win. Of course, like has two, he has three passed pawns, and you must try to consolidate the situation. First of all, black is threatening h5, so you must play this move first, just to get that pawn. Black tries to keep the pawn. Now, very important move, a very, I think, very instructive move, because the main idea is that black wants to play a3 here. You have to play this move. King e6. King h5. D4, it's the best try. And now if you play bishop takes d4, a3 is a draw. So you have to play this to force him to play king d6, and now you can play bishop takes d4, king takes c6. Now also interesting, because he has only one move that wins. And that's this move. It's the idea that you have still the time to pick up the pawns, but you cannot do it with the king, because the king has to keep the g pawn. And here you manage to get him, because you have complete control again over the position. Let me see. What else? We still have some studies, I think, that are very interesting. Ah, yeah, there's a study that is dedicated to the memory of Misha Tal, and I changed it a little bit, yeah. I think it's a nice idea, the study. This is based on the Prokes principle. Yeah, this is the position. The idea is that white should win. And it's a bit tricky because you have to try to get this, keep these pawns. But also you have to do, of course you have to play for mate as well. But how to do it exactly? You need this knight. If you play this, you take the knight and black is actually winning because these pawns are very powerful and there's no mate. So you have to start with this move, threatening mate. You play bishop e3, then king e2, and you can just, this is funny, c2, you can just take mate. So the main line is after knight a3 is knight g6. King e2. What to do? I mean, this is just lost if you don't do something. Look, you, now you play for the Procas principle. This is what they call the Procas principle. Is that you? It is similar. It looks like this. What I showed before, yeah, with the sans urtueta position. I mean, the problem for white is that he has to get rid of this rook, and then he can take the pawn. Otherwise, the pawns are just very dangerous. Threatening c1, of course. And apart from taking here, but if you move the rook. So here you play this. First you start with this. You have time, because black has no checks. Of course, here you're threatening mate, so you cannot do anything here. You cannot take with the king. It's very simple then, rook b6. You can take the rook, but I take both pawns. Okay, take it like this. Check. In here. Now you have this, again, this disappearing trick. Because here you have still the same problem, you have no checks. The knight was here, and there's a line with f5. Check, check, and finally you get the winning ending. But the nicest is this. Is if you, so we have this position. You play knight h5. It's king takes h5. Now still not clear what white can do. It's g4 check. King cannot take here because this, cannot take here because this, but f takes. Finally, you make this queen, but check. So you cannot get here, and you win the end game. So this is a very interesting way of using this theme. Let me see, I have a... this is actually quite... Of course, far too many studies that I could show, but this is actually a nice study here. Yeah, this one, yeah. Yeah, this is a study, and white should win the position. There's one more pawn on f3. White should win the position. This pawn is here. I have everything okay here. Yeah. Now, of course, it's a funny position because here the computer, in the beginning, you know, it just doesn't see the problem. He believes that white is completely winning in many different ways. But after a while, he sees that this queen is a problem. Put it anywhere else on the board, of course. It's not a study. So you have to start like this. There are some interesting lines. I show the main line. There are many lines, of course, here. But this is the only move. King f6. Rook d7. It's made after study by Simkowitz, but this study is very simple that he has. But this is a big improvement. Queen h8. You have to get rid of this bishop. Yeah, this is, of course, the point. And then try to get out. How to do it. Yeah, threatening here. White has to be careful, yeah. If he would lose both pawns, then he could lose the game. You have knight. Check. Takes. King takes. And rook takes f4. Now, if you take that rook, it's easy. But black has a different move. Here's this. Okay. It's not so easy for white now. Rook cannot get back. So best to do is this. It's the only way to win. Check. If you play king e7, the rook comes back. Still have to play a bit carefully, but then you win. Main line is king f6. So we have no rook checks now. But now the miracle happens. Because here, the color of the queen changes. I can show a last final study, which is also based on some known ideas. And also with Novotny, there's also an idea of Gurganits and Mitrofanov, who are also fantastic study composers, but the study they made was not so good. There were some problems. As always, if you have a complicated idea, you work with the computer, sometimes it goes wrong. Rook on g4. curious here. Yeah, that's it. That's it. So actually, White is, should be winning. He has a problem that, of course, yes, two pawns that come out, but Black is threatening here. So you start with this move. That's clear. This. And now, okay, it's clear that White, if he wants to win, he has to do some form of procast to get, but how exactly? The funny thing is that the next move is very difficult to see. First of all, it should be noted that if you play bishop h4, it should be quite okay. If you take with the ID knight g5, there's always rook take g7. But the solution here is that White should play b6. Why do you play b6? That will be seen a lot later. Mistake, it is black. Knight e7. That is the trick, because here you sacrifice all three pieces, because if you sacrifice only two pieces, it's not enough. Because here, okay, now you don't have this anymore, so you can play bishop h4. You take. Now, it's interesting here, the move is Black's best defense is bishop f2. And now you see the point of b6. Knight f3, and you don't have bishop b6. That was the whole idea. You had to play b6 first, and then to sacrifice the three pieces. And this endgame is winning for White. But I have a lot of cases where some great composers had great ideas. I think it's a great idea to sacrifice three pieces, three minor pieces to get this working. And then but the study was not correct that Mitrofanov and Gurganich made. In my opinion, it is very important to try to restore this old jewels from the past, to give it a new form where it's completely computer checked, and it's absolutely it's crystal clear that ID works. I have many such cases here in these two books, and well, this is just one lecture. Some other time. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Okay.